Good evening, everyone. What a great crowd on a Saturday night. We're really thrilled to see you here. My name is John Culshaw. I'm the university librarian, and I'm pleased to welcome you to the University of Iowa Libraries this evening. We are really pleased to host Andrei Codrescu this evening, and are so glad that you could join us. If you haven't done so already, I hope you'll take the opportunity to tour the exhibition next door in our gallery, Documenting Dada, Disseminating Dada. The exhibition is the work of my colleague, Timothy Scheib, right here in the front row. Yes, please. So if you don't know Tim, Tim is a longtime member of the UI Libraries staff, and he's the curator of the International Dada Archive, the world's most comprehensive collection of textual material related to the Dada movement that happens to reside right here in the main library. Tim is widely considered to be a leading expert on Dada and serves as the editor of the peer-reviewed journal Dada/Surrealism. I want to thank Tim for curating the exhibition and all of his excellent work in building and preserving this very important collection. So thanks to Tim. Tonight's talk was made possible by funding from the journal Dada Surrealism, which is published here at the University of Iowa Libraries, and Mr. Codrescu's extended stay in Iowa City was made possible by support from the Newsom Lecture Fund of the School of Library and Information Science, from the MA program in Literary Translation, and from the International Writing Program. The exhibition was made possible through support from the Friends of the UI Libraries. So please join me in thanking all of our generous supporters and welcome Tim Scheib to the podium to introduce our speaker. Thanks so much.
Thanks. Is this still on?
Still on?
Thank you, John.
Thank you, John.
I would like to add my thanks to Jennifer, Jess, Cheryl, and everyone in the libraries who helped to plan this event. I really appreciate your help. Just a couple of logistical details. As you may have noticed, there are signed copies of three of Andrei Codrescu's books available at a table outside the auditorium. We have, of course, the Posthuman Dada Guide. We have Bibliodef, of special interest to librarians, and his latest poetry collection, The Art of Forgetting. Now, if you'd like your, these are pre-signed, but if you'd like your copy personalized, Andrei has kindly agreed to do a signing session following his talk. And also, please join us for a reception after the talk. The exhibition will be open until 9. We only ask that you avoid bringing food or beverages into the gallery. So in 1997, at the headquarters of the Romanian Cultural Foundation in Bucharest, Andrei Codrescu was honored in a ceremony marking his 50th birthday. The ceremony was attended by numerous celebrities, including writers, literary critics, and former presidential candidates, and it received substantial media coverage. Andrei later wrote the following about the event. The speeches were long and the crowd polite. Why are speeches so long in this country? I later asked him. If they are not long, nobody thinks it serious, he said. He was serious. So I suppose my introduction then is supposed to last at least half an hour or is that about right? No. Yep. So, but I'm not much of a talker, so if I don't actually talk that long, I hope you'll still think I'm serious. I'm not going to dwell on the things you already know about Andrei Codrescu. Many of you know him through his witty and insightful commentaries that were heard for many years on National Public Radio. Or you might know him as a master of practically every genre of writing, fiction, poetry, drama, nonfiction prose, and even cinema. Andrei belongs to a venerable tradition of Romanians who became writers somewhere else than Romania. But he broke with tradition in becoming an American writer. You know, Romanians are supposed to become French writers. So, and what's more remarkable is that English is his fourth or fifth language, depending on how you count your languages. Instead of dwelling on all this, I'll just mention three things you might not know about Andrei Codrescu. One is just how significant a cultural figure he is in his native country, a country that he left more than 50 years ago. I first realized this a few years ago when I happened to be in Romania just before one of Andrei's return visits to his native land. At least 10 people must have mentioned Andrei's impending arrival, and they were all visibly excited by the prospect and told me how unlucky I was to be missing his talks, even though they'd have been in Romanian and I wouldn't have understood them. They even urged me to stay an extra week so I could hear him. And several Romanian writers and scholars in their 30s and 40s have mentioned to me how much Andrei's writings, especially The Disappearance of the Outside, had influenced their thinking in the years immediately following the 1989 revolution. The second thing is, and this fact alone would have qualified himself to give this evening's talk, Andrei has a son named Tristan, named after Tristan Tzara, the co-founder of Dada. And third, and most importantly, Andrei is a remarkably warm, kind, and generous person. And he's been especially generous with his time, both while preparing for his visit to Iowa City and during his 2 days here. When we invited him to come and speak, Andrei immediately offered to arrive a day early so he could meet with students and faculty. And for the past 2 days, he has kept a heroic schedule and shared his insights and humor with dozens in our community. And for that, I really want to thank him from the bottom of my heart. So now, as the culmination of Andrei's visit, here is the long-awaited sequel to Andrei Codrescu's Posthuman Dada Guide.
Thank you, Tim, for those kind words, and thank you especially for this remarkable exhibit. I hope everyone does view. There are at least half of the items that are unknown to me. Is the mic on? No. Oh, okay. I remember pushing the big button. Oh yeah, is this, oh. Mute this guy, okay. Is it mute now? Is it mute? Yeah, I guess it is. Okay. All right, so this is better. I wanted to thank Tim for his kind words and but also for this exhibition that I hope everyone will see, because it is quite extraordinary. I didn't see half of the items in here, and when I was writing my book on Dada, I looked at an awful lot of publications and objects that are somehow connected to the movement, and I saw photographs of some of the items here in other books. But to have them actually close, there is something about it. It's ineffable, and it's wonderful that they're here. It's also wonderful that this collection is here in Iowa City. And I mean, I don't think it's as strange as having the great history of science collection at the University of Oklahoma in Tulsa, which is weird and sudden. But You know, because whether, you know, I mean, here in Iowa City, in the 1970s, there was a powerful Dada-influenced literary movement. That's the actualist, and Dave Maurice, who is Dave? He's around. So there he is, the brilliant founders of actualism. Is here too. So this, you know, there was, whether you knew each other or not, I'm not sure what the connection is, but the fact that, you know, Dada inspired living writers' activity took place here at a certain point makes a great deal of sense. So, you know, Dada is here, and now this other thing is here as well. So, and then, of course, the writing workshops and so on. So it is good to be here, and it is good to be here again, because I've been here. And it's great that it's February and it's this weather outside, because I thought you made a sort of bubble of weather, especially for me, because it's a tropical flower from New Orleans. I tend to shrivel. So I'm, and I want to thank everybody who was so terrific in the last few days. We had lots of conversations, and I said everything I have to say. So I thought, my friends Anka and Raj actually took me to some antique house, sort of a junk store, here, and I found this extraordinary thing. It's a. It's part of the performance. It's a sack, plastic sack filled with slides, and the viewer. But we don't have a projector. I have no idea what's on them. I asked the guy if he knew what was on them, and he said, no, I was a guy from somewhere, so I didn't know, and I thought that maybe we could project these. Be a perfectly Dada thing to do, and maybe it's actually, these are slides of, you know, I don't know, Masterson Johnson's study of American sexuality, you know. Could very well be. I mean, this, it's unseen, unknown, it's a treasure. However, there is no projector. It's very, would be a difficult thing to set up. However, you know, should you become enchanted by this idea somehow, maybe we could work something out. A special midnight viewing. Anyway, it's here. So, you know, this is the mystery object. I brought some other things to show and tell. Mostly, just stuff. But then, you know, I thought, well, you know, the best ideas do come from left field, and they're sudden, and they become so interesting. And I would have loved to have a projector and just simply show the slides and. Maybe say a thing or two about them. They reminded me of a performance that was quite deliberate, actually, of my dear friend David Franks, who was a conceptual artist, among other things, a musician, a poet. And one of his performances involved the old typewriters, whiteout strips, those things you put in the typewriter to take out typos, mistakes, letters that didn't fit, and I mean, they're not correct. Something that spell check now sort of eliminates with, you know, this kind of disdain for typos, which is really one of the great mistakes of American literature. And, but, well, I truly hate spell check. But what David did, you know, this is one of his talks, is he saved the strips of his mistakes that he took out of the typewriter. He turned them into slides. And then he projected them. And then in a somewhat professorial tone, he explained his typos. A bit Freudian and a bit Kabbalistic. It was always an interesting speech. He changed it, you know, it was about an hour. looking at something to bring that is more in the spirit of Dada, and we're going to also have a conversation temporarily. Ask me whether we could have a Q&A, and I said, oh, absolutely, we can do that. And so, you know, if I miss introducing Dada, it's because Dada does not like to be introduced. He just shows up, like certain guests, then overstays. He did this for about 100 years. We are celebrating the centenary of Dada, and Dada hasn't aged at all. So what is with Dada? Well, I wrote a poem about Dada, actually, and I didn't have a copy of it here, so I had to have it printed by Anka. It's called Big Dada. I don't know how Dada got so big. It grew so fast. It's only 100 years old and it's still a baby. But the tallest cell tower hormone, it seems only yesterday that she said to me, Grandma, why are your eyes so big? Grandma, why are your nostrils so big? Grandma, why are your teeth so sharp and huge? And she said, put that goddamn magnifying glass and go outside and play. So I put down that magnifying glass and went outside and played to get bigger and bigger. Until I got so big I couldn't get back in the house, and Grandma said, Dada, why don't you get yourself a suit made out of newspapers and go live in a Dutch museum? It seems like only yesterday we auctioned off Dada stuff. Now it's back. It must be Duchamp's DNA. I was in Romania as well for the anniversary. It was a rather awkward anniversary, actually, because quite a few of the people who put on the Dada show weren't quite sure if this thing was serious in some way, or it was a century-old joke that somehow the Western world, driven by demons, bought. They didn't quite get it that it came from there, but it did change the 20th century and the 21st, as it turns out, in that there was nothing about Dada that actually has rusted, as opposed to many other isms that came along, surrealism among them, but other isms, other kinds of things like modernism, which is a kind of an Anglo umbrella for innovation in the arts and writing. So Dada was never really Dadaism in the sense that the beats were never beatniks. I mean, these were easy ways to cover a large territory to say, well, Dadaism, then it's a movement. Then you can incorporate it chronologically into a number of them. Symbolism, cubism, Dadaism, whatever fits in there, Impressionism, etc. And then you can sort of dispose of it and it becomes museumified. It can be put safely in the museum and it loses its subversive power. And Dada just won't do that, because the Dada writers and artists who began in 1916 at Cabaret Voltaire in Zurich deliberately set out to create a revolt that would not allow itself to be made chronological, historical, displayable, viewable, and museum ready. That would deny itself. In fact, Dada, which became a very known, well-known movement, was never clear to anyone in understanding how it came to be named Dada and what that word meant. So thereby hangs a long story of battles over the copyright of the word, and whether it was coined by Tristan Tzara or Hulsenbeck. So the Tzara Romanian French faction would have the Tzara finding the word in a particular Rus by opening the book and seeing it, and by the German faction, which would have done it in the same fashion, more or less. Of course, da means yes in Romanian and in Russian, and so Tim had an entirely original idea about this whole business, which I'd never heard before, which was that it wasn't really either the French, Romanian, or the Germans, but, you know, it was the fact that there were so many Romanians around and that they heard da all the time, da, 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 because when he was in Romania, he said da, 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 it was everywhere. And it seemed sort of naturally to have arisen there at certain points. So that's terrific because it just doesn't kind of closes this this century-old battle. In the spirit of the whoever it was that found the word Dada, which at some point Picabia said, Dada, ça ne signifie rien. So, ça signifie rien. Dada, it means nothing. It means nothing. So, yes, indeed, Dada means nothing. But nothing is everything, as you know from practicing Zen every day. All of you, of course. Nothing is what we contain and the space that is truly something, about the only something there is nothing. That paradox cannot be, you can twist it and change it and it still will turn out to be interesting. So in this, I was reading, for some reason sort of nodding off at reading my Twitter feed. And I came on an article about an interview with Larry Hagman, the actor who in Dallas and I Dream of Jeannie, talking about his LSD experiences. Actually, my plan was not to give away who said this, but okay. It was kind of a mixture of animistic and soul, and we are all of that. Everything with soul in there, inside, where we have blooming guts and so forth inside of us. We're growing all the time, and that pulse went along with my song, which was a pulse. Da, 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 na, da, 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 da. And this thing would explode. And the life force, like sperm, would come out of that explosion, and then I would wrap back up again, and I would get a song going, and it would pulse and pulse and pulse and pulse and pulse, and then boom, spread our seed through the universe. Whoa, boy, that was different. You ever had anything like that? Man, I just read this text, and not so, then said Larry Hagman, and I will get a much bigger laugh, but there you go. Learning the art of speaking as we make it up as we go along. So, what is it actually? And this is the mystery, and this exhibition to some extent does explain that. The Dada, the original Cabaret Voltaire, and then the Cabaret Voltaire would have evaporated in a few days if it was not for the sort of publicity genius of Tristan Tzara and, Hugo Ball, of course, because they were writers and they did start making publications early on. Now, Tzara had already made with his friend Ion Vina and some other young experimenting writers in Romania some publications. And these are extremely rare and hard to find, and one is here actually. It's HP 75, HP 75, which was named for horsepower and motor, which was novel in the sense that at the time when Dada, the word didn't exist, but futurism did. And so the first Manifesto of the Century began with Marinetti's Futurist Manifesto, which was published in France at the same time as it was in Romania. So it appeared in Contemporain, simultaneously. So the Futurist Manifesto opened this sort of crowded door to the future for all sorts of young artists who were trying to find, they knew it, there was an opening, that something momentous was going to happen, and they wanted to be ready for it. And the Futurist Manifesto made it possible. It seemed to, it certainly did that. But the manifesto was one thing, and then actually producing a new kind of writing and art was another. And from the beginning, the young Romanians were interested in poetry and the possibilities of poetry and in type. And so, really, the only signature Dada object is one of type, of playing with typography, which was also a new way of presenting the world through newspapers at the time. And so quite a few of the Dada works were cut from the newspapers, which were a novel way of, in a more democratic way of spreading the word, or the words. So Romania, where everything is speeded up by the fact that Romania itself was no more than, in 1916, it really was no more than 50 years old as a nation. Experiments in writing and art, they just succeeded each other incredibly fast, and they had twice the 75 HP. It was a motor that was running very quickly. So symbolists came and went, and the traditionalisms of various kinds came and went, and they were in themselves a kind of modernism and experimentation, because it was a young nation that was experimenting with inventing itself. And it did, very successfully. If you look at this periodic table of elements, see the RU, the 44? That's the Romanian element. Many people spell it that way. It's the old spelling of Romanian. It's over here, too. So the it's already when just toward the start of the First World War, and the very heavy clouds was hanging over Europe. Tzara left Romania for Switzerland, neutral country, and although there was no war yet for Romania, but he did leave early on for reasons having to do with the atmosphere of the time. And found himself in Zurich with a number of people who were trying to escape the coming cataclysm, which had then started. And instead of lasting 2 weeks, like everyone thought, it became an incredible slaughter of millions of people. And the absurdity of it just didn't escape anyone, including the people who were dying at the front. This is one of the things that Robert Motherwell, in his great anthology of Dada, quotes a number of people from the front actually talking about how they were dying like sheep, just walking into enemy fire, and how absurd it seemed to them as well. And so there was a great cataclysm there. In the middle of this, there was Zurich, which was a neutral, well, funny word, but really a shelter for refugees from all over Europe. Artists, writers, revolutionaries like Lenin. Lenin lived five houses up from Cabaret Voltaire and Spiegelgasse 10, I think. Cabaret Voltaire or Spiegelgasse 1. And, there have been an extraordinary mixture of people and minds crossing or crowding into this, small Swiss city. and for the artists and the writers there and the people thinking, there were only two refuges, really a library where Lenin was most of the time with his, you know, making his studies, trying to figure out how to make the revolution because he had failed in 1905 and he was in exile and he was working, reworking his ideas. And then for the artists and the writers, there were two cafes, really, were the only thing was going on. So at some point in, this is where I first read it in Tom Stoppard's play, Travesties, which some of you had have probably seen. There is a terrific scene where young Tristan Tzara, a newly arrived Romanian poet who is participating in some sort of nightclub, is playing chess with the middle-aged Lenin in a cafe. And neither one of them really knows how important this game was, because at that game of chess, if it had taken place, and of course some people say it has, some say it hasn't, chess was one of the very few ways that you could get away from the noise around you, from the constant rumor mill, from the tension, from the craziness, from the fact that people had their kin and their brothers, their sisters, their parents all die in the war, and they were, so there was a noise, there was a constant, you know, pounding, background pounding. But the one way to make an island of silence was to play chess. Because chess was the game that stays suspended. So if you, for a moment, you see a young poet who was instrumental in changing the look, the art, and the thinking of the 20th century playing chess with the other power who ended up changing the 20th century and until recently, and you suspend them in time for a moment, and you don't know which one of them is going to win this game. You're looking at Tzara and you think, well, this is a poet who makes scandalous and silly things happen at this loud nightclub, which is, you know, looks crazy to most people, but in fact it's a nursery for all sorts of experiments in art that are going to take hold for the rest of the century. And you're looking at him and you know, and then on the other side of this is Lenin, who's, you know, who returns to Russia from Switzerland and with the help of the High German Command and makes the successful revolution of 1917, you know, which gave us the Soviet Union until 1991. And the effects of it are still, you know, within us and around us and through us. So these two opposing ways of looking at the world are actually locked into this game of chess. And in doing that, I mean, I just, whether the game took place or not, I read quite a bit about the history of chess and, you know, how chess reflected the various times in which it was played, and it was always a sort of philosophy of warfare. It was very different when chess was played at the beginning in Persia or, you know, whatever its putative origin may be. But there is an actual story of a Hungarian traveler at the time, you know, maybe 16th, 17th century, who is playing chess with a Syrian player. And his opponent moves all the pieces as soon as he gets a hold of them. And the Hungarian waits politely for his turn. And finally, the sort of astonished opponent says, well, why aren't you moving? And he says, well, you know, we don't play like this. He comes from a courtly world where you take your turn and there's a sort of manner of playing, which just totally astonishes the other. So we don't do that. We just move as quickly as possible. You know, sort of blitzkrieg in there, you know. So anyway, this is the conceit of my Posthuman book, and it is, you know, there are several things that hang on this chess game, but also on the fact that Dada found a very fertile ground in America, and that there was it had an uninterrupted career as a prompter and nurturer of new artistic and literary movements and ideas. So some of that you can tell there, some of that, you know. So my book really takes it for granted that everybody sort of heard about it, just like you say, well, but unlike saying, well, I've seen a surrealist painting, which is easy enough to think. I mean, anyone who's seen a surrealist painting sort of has an idea of what a surrealist painting is, and really, is able to connect it to dream world and the fantastic and all those notions that went into the building the surrealist, you know, dogma. You say Dada, it is very difficult to get any kind of image. You know, you just get an image of a bunch of rowdies making people cry by moving around and singing songs that don't belong to them and mixing sentimental schlager with made-up poetry on the spot and reading it simultaneously. All sorts of things that later, you know, were picked up and taken further by Dave Morris. For that reason, there is in Allen Ginsberg's wonderful poem Howl, which is another beginning for another time and art, there is the great line. He says, "He who threw potato salad at the lecturer on Dada." So I've been talking now for about, I don't know, 6 months about Dada. And I'm expecting at any moment that potato salad to come flying. You look like no potato salad. Okay, well, at least in Iowa, I thought potato salad. That's why usually I surround myself with all sorts of shields. And I came completely in armor. Because the Dada activity of listening to a lecture on Dada would elicit, you know, an activity like throwing potato salad. And that's only because Alan said potato salad, but it could be anything, really. Don't. Beatnik is sort of the same problem, has the same problem as Dadaism, because the beats were really named beatniks by San Francisco Chronicle columnist who, the time the Sputnik had just gone up, decided that he would coin a cute name for these unwashed, drunk, sandal-wearing people who were populating North Beach, and so he's who were calling themselves beats, but then he added the nick, beatnik. So beatnik became very understandable, and popular culture picked it up very fast. And as opposed to being, well, it was museumified at the same time, but it really did work into popular culture, where Dada did as well, as you can see from Larry Hagman's almost spontaneous incantations of Dada on LSD, that the word had the power to do that, whether you voluntarily you really know anything about it or not. So at some point, one of them, the circle said, well, Dada is the single most powerful word in language. It's probably more powerful than God. And frivolous and shocking, but not untrue. It is a very powerful word, especially since, you know, it can't be, you know, it can't very easily attach that history, the ism to it. You know? And whatever remains of the beat that's still powerful is because of the beat, not because of the neck. So with that in mind, and without a projector, I'm going to oraculate. I've never done that in front of an audience. This is my new book of poetry, which is called The Art of Forgetting, which I've been practicing to beat my brain at it. So my brain gets ahead of me and forgets things for me, and I don't like that. But actually, to forget things that you'd like to get out of your hard drive and just make room on purpose is really a very perverse process, because to forget them, you have to first remember them, which reinforces the memory. Then to write it doubles the ante on that. And then to have it translated into Romanian will reinforce it even further. And then to know the language it's being translated in, which it just was, is even worse, because then you have to figure out why the Romanian cannot say what you said in English. And so I intervened in the translation and I rewrote some of the Romanian, and then I had to rewrite some of the English so I could get a little closer. So this is the only, everything I wanted to forget by writing this book has become unforgettable. Impossible to forget. In fact, it pushed out almost everything else I wanted. I may have wanted to remember. So, what I then use this book for, since I clearly can't either forget it or somehow I need to use it. And one of the ways I would use it is to ask it questions, open it, and let my eyes fall on the given line, and then answer the question. Now, I don't want to do this myself because, you know, I mean, although. Usually when I don't know the answer to a question, I just ask myself and then I answer. It's possible. But I thought I would just use it as an oracle and the Dada oracle and just take some questions actually from the audience. They have nothing to do with our later Q&A, which could be serious. But you can ask any question at all, you know, grave or frivolous. And I'm going to open my book of unforgettable paints, and answer. And if the book answers, fine. If it's oblique, well, then there is a space to figure things out. And if it doesn't, if it answers it very correctly, then you can tremble in fear of the word and language, because it is indeed a powerful virus, and it is ordering almost our entire biofilm. You know, I mean, that was good. Good start. Anybody? Question? This is not a Q&A, by the way. Yes?
Why did I have tacos for dinner?
Why did you?
Yeah, why did I have tacos?
No se puede vivir sin amar. This is a quote from García Lorca. One cannot live without love. So I don't know why you had tacos, but obviously there is some romantic interest involved in that, or just simply love of tacos. Trying not to explain this too much, but yeah. It's a poem, so I'll read the work too, just to clarify this question of tacos. Movies are much sadder than life. Life hurts more and lasts longer. Unable to give or receive love to or from those nearest, the poet gave and received it to and from all strangers, died from what remained untouched at his fingertips. Did you finish your taco? Yeah. No. Right. We'll do about four or five of these, you know, and I mean, it's a reading, but, you know, we can reconnect with Dada in the serious question answer period part of this exercise. Speaking of exercises, actually, since nobody seems to be eager to ask questions, and it's plugging me in further,
Part of the post-human definition, everybody says there's another mysterious word, zero, the post-human Dada guide is what exactly is a post-human. So, you know, it's usually I ask people, they ask me that, ask them how many wires they are carrying on their body or they're connected to. And the more wires you have, the more post-human you are, you know, until the point where there will be no wires, in which case you'll not be human anymore. You'll be some other form of, I would say life or mechanics, or electronics. My book is pro-human, by the way. Written by a post-human, because I wrote it entirely on the computer. So. And I wouldn't have even printed out a copy, so it won't. But I mean, I did print out a copy to send to a friend who refuses to read on the screen. So speaking of exercises, while you're thinking of your question, I want to tell. This is the odd exercise of memory that I used in writing The Art of Forgetting. I gave a talk on Dada, a lecture on Dada at the San Francisco Institute of Art on October 9, 2016, on the night of the election. And so I prepared my students, I was with them for 2 weeks, and we prepared a number of performances for that night. And we had a hall very similar to this one, and on a screen behind me, CNN on silent was reporting the election. Now, in California, we were 3 hours behind the rest of the country, so the audience already looked distressed. But I didn't see it because I had my back to it. And so I gave this lecture, and my students interrupted it with a number of performances, and I would just stop the lecture, and Dada would go stop. And election would be back there. The one performance that had a lot to do with what was going on the screen behind me were two students, two young women, one dressed in blue and one in red, who had a dog they brought on stage. His name was Chewy. And the dog didn't belong to either one of them because they didn't want to, because they were both calling to him to see who the dog was going to go to, the red or the blue, which the dog would decide the election, essentially. And the dog didn't know either one of them, and they both were saying, here, Chewy. No, Chewy went toward one, then toward the other, then toward the other, then toward the other, just swinging, just then all of a sudden the dog just ran through the audience, he just bolted and found an open door and just went straight out of the hall. One smart dog. So I will read a bit of this because this is just for the tone of what was going on, because now you have a background of this whole event, and the fact that the audience was really nervous. There's a great deal of emotion going around. So I was unperturbed because I didn't know and I didn't see. Given the history being made today, this was then, I would like to note some types of history offered in San Francisco this week and ask questions that all these histories must somehow answer. The most urgent history is obviously unfolding right now, and it's not even history yet, but it certainly is now. It's tomorrow's history, of course, tomorrow's history. We know very well what it was. So this history will have some time to answer, though I hope it will do this in less than 100 years. Well, as we all know, it is doing that. The 100 year later histories of Dada are the stories of the historical Dada and don't get more interesting, fortunately, than Dada when it was actually happening in 1916. History is at loggerheads with Dada, which was a cry of, we want to fuck up the world and we want to do it now. Familiar, of course, from later Dada. telling the story of a group of poets and artists who wanted to fuck up the world in 1916 is instructive in the sense that history fucked them up instead. At this point, a student just came out of the audience running up and just beating a war drum. And the woman on the different side of the room started screaming this poem to people next to her, and they were really aggressive and very chilling. And given what we thought about the election, how it was going to turn out in the end, because we all thought Hillary Clinton actually had it locked up, I thought that their performances were too violent and they were too actually aggressive. But as it turned out, they were absolutely right. And the poem was just ferocious and screaming as ferocious. But each one of these performances we timed to last exactly 1 minute. I mean, we had that down. It's very hard to teach people what 1 minute is. I know because I've been on the radio, but you know, the students, you know, they brought these endless poems and they said, this is a minute. This was not a minute. So there were things to learn, but silence falls again, then the lecturer continues unperturbed. When the war they hated, that is the Dadaists, was over, they were delivered to the vicious chronologies of culture wars and its unfolding ideas about the kind of world they wanted. Leaving aside this internecine fronds, there was big history, always rolling its indifferent tanks over the bodies of sensitives. Bolshevism in Russia didn't particularly distinguish between pacifists and bystanders. Very few people noted that Cabaret Voltaire's neighbor on Spiegelgasse in Zurich was Vladimir Ilyich Lenin. Now, the fact that the revolution, the Russian revolution, didn't distinguish between pacifists and bystanders is also one of the signatures of Dada. Because the other artists and writers didn't believe in the audience. They believed in participation, that you had in some way to participate. So they did not believe in the audience either, but unlike Lenin, they didn't eliminate it. but in some way, they made it part of, you know, the subsequent movements that involved the audience. So, you know, the audience eliminated by artistic means does have the advantage of continuing to live, eat, and have sex, but whereas in Russia that was not the case. So at this point we had another performance, a very angry performance, a various what kind of a mix of this punk lyrics that the students had collaged from different anthems of the 70s, so I mean of the 80s, 90s. Another performance, then when Lenin's ideological murder machine was finished in 1991, Dada and the Dadaists began to be remembered as the circusy grouplet that was the only one to issue a radical and uncompromising no to all the European philosophy and art that ended up feeding the murder machines of Lenin and later incarnations of Stalin and Hitler. Until now, maybe few historians and certainly fewer curators and collectors entertained even vaguely the idea of any genuine equivalence between the ideology of communism, fascism, and Hitlerism and the chaos of the Dada circus. This equivalence remained invisible because the chronological and narrative vice of history-telling or object fetishism depend on their coherence for seeing an anti-historical, anti-narrative action as just an element of their story, a detail of whatever was boiling in the Zurich soup. At this point, the student takes off his clothes and rushes the stage holding a potato and a cabbage and a cauliflower, oh, and an onion, and shouts, postmodern veggies, and throws them into the onion. Well, this is San Francisco, so it's a little more charged. You know. but indeed, these are the postmodern vegetables, especially the cabbage and the onion, because you just open them and you keep, you know, the center is very elusive, you know, it's, you know, you just keep peeling away. Of course, you know, the cabbage lost a few of its layers on the way to the audience. It did hit somebody, San Francisco Institute was seriously concerned that we would have a lawsuit. The world is falling apart. Somebody gets hit by a cabbage. There's a lecture on Dada, and the SFAI is worried about the loss, the law. Okay, but yet, continues the lecturer, Tzara, the Dadaist, and Lenin, the Bolshevik, played chess. Two men, two opponents, chaos and art against ideology and class war. At the time, chess was real. The powers behind the board stayed within the laws of chess, because that's what they're called, they're rules, they're laws of chess. The laws of chess, and neither player knew the stakes. They didn't know that they were playing for the world of the coming century. The claims of the Dadaists were grand, grandiose and poetic, but unlike the many unfolding art novelties around them, they remained resolute in their negativity. About the big no, they called out to historical storytelling. To give any legitimacy to the Dada movement, historians would have to take Dada seriously. So during this entire lecture, the two students have been playing chess at the corner of the table with the big screen of the CNN. Going on silence, and to the left of the podium, they threw a small shadow on the screen that was barely noticed. It was almost like this was the, sort of another narrative. It's a bit like there was a television show, actually, of some two people watching old movies and commenting on the silliness of them, and you could see their silhouettes talking. I can't remember what the name of it was, but it was a great idea. Because they all, what was it? Oh yeah, that's it. Right. Yeah, great idea. Did somebody here did that, do that? I mean, because it was done by a couple of people who are not in New York or in Los Angeles. In Minneapolis, that's that. Oh, I don't know if they had some kind of Midwestern angle. Those movies are slow enough for them to make their comments, and their comments are not that fast if you look at it now. You know, you have this. Question again, lecturer. I mean, you have to put a minute of performance between these things, which is not happening except that I'm replaying it. So something is going on, because now we know the answer. At this point I was delivering this, and the performances were going on, I didn't know what was going to happen. So question, why did big history take Lenin seriously? And why did big history not take Tristan Tzara seriously? If big history and its historians would have taken both Tzara and Lenin seriously, what would the world look like now? And part of the same question, what would have happened if the spontaneous procedures of Dada would have gained the interest that Lenin and later ideologists did? So at this place, point, we had a very sweet kind of national melody, something composed there straight out of a romantic period of a harp. One of my students was a harpist, and she just made these sounds that were like the sounds of a Fourierist utopia, some sheep wandering in the meadow, and the sound of a pear about, well, if it makes a sound about the fall. The pear, of course, being the Fourier's favorite metaphor for the perfect fruit. At this point, these sounds, you know, sort of wrenching, nostalgic sounds enter the room, and a pear falls down in front of the screen. It's a very ripe pear, and it explodes on stage. Then a whole lot of pears start falling all over the room. People take them, pick them up, and they're ripe, and they're eating them. Again, we're in the land of fruits and vegetables, so. All these things are fraught with local history. Here we could probably throw hams around or something. So the same question continued, you know, when the tumult, the noise of the student performance died out. And the lecturer said the same question continued. What would have happened if the spontaneous procedures of Dada would have gained interest the way other revolutionary ideologies did, or other revolutionary ideologies, because I wouldn't call Dada an ideology, but what allowed ideologies and philosophical rhetorics to run syntactically correct social upheavals unchecked by the boredom of the audience that they didn't believe in, indeed seeking audiences and their boredom to create the vacuum in which to exercise the power of exterminating them. At this point, I had a very violent feminist in my class rise up and start to address a series of rapid-fire questions to various members of the audience, including this poor guy who was just sitting next to her, and she said, "Did you kill a woman today?" He was completely startled. It was a very direct question, and obviously he hadn't, but he didn't know what to say. His questions might seem, this was absurd, just like my questions, but previous until now seem somewhat absurd. The question seems absurd because there were many other articulate leftists or nationalists or artistic chunks of gristle in the Zurich soup, including communists who are busy classifying people in identifiable categories, workers, the bourgeoisie, capitalists, the intelligentsia, the proletariat, the lumpen proletariat, and so on. And they were creating classes of people who were altogether a mass, which they set out to fight for class interests. The masses were an invention of pamphleteering. Before the masses, there were mobs, crowds, le foule, the mob in all the uprisings, and proletarians were city dwellers, peasants, monks, beggars, and industrialization, factory workers and laborers. So really the classes that were defined in Lenin's ideology didn't see the masses, this sort of rhetoric of well-defined classes didn't exist for most of the philosophical writing of Europe until pretty late, until the end of the 19th century. So this work of classifying and identifying adversary interests was less creative, of course, than the grotesque puppets that Marcel Janco created for Cabaret Voltaire, or later on for the absolutely fantastic outfits and ways of manifesting publicly that the Baroness von Freytag-Loringhoven wore in New York, including a live cage with a burden, But the work of classifying, what I mean to say without these parentheses, is that the work of classifying and identifying adversary interests were not creative. They were set, and the puppets and the invention that the extensions of the thinking of the artists were constantly renewing themselves while people steeped in a century of complete sentences were infinitely more boring, and they were producing brain death and sleep, just like this last sentence might have in some of you. So, can anyone remember what I just said? No. Have another question? Yes.
If
all your senses are occupied, God will have no place to sit. If all your circuits are busy, the unknown can't reach you. Mystery doesn't like call waiting. It hangs up and calls someone else. You must always keep a line open despite your job in the glass prison, your full-time job in the glass prison, building layers in the glass prison, using your imagination of freedom to perfect the transparency of glass. The end of your polishing job is the end of your imagination. You see your chained insect legs for a second before you expire. Greater transparency, no leg room. The flight attendant apologizes. There is transparency in the hive, all but your once self visible. So I would say when is when you get out of the glass house, which we all live in at the moment. A glass house being, you know, that's one place where everybody else can see you, but you're just looking at yourself in the reflection of the of your images. You know, very pertinent metaphor now, especially because we all live in a glass house that has our various reflections reflected back to us by the mirror of media. And then you sort of wonder why people who watch this throw stones. So the when is actually when, you know, there's a break here, which I don't quite see, but there is one. So, that answer the question? Well, I am going to end with a few of my naked students. They're probably in here, actually, they're prototypes. Who rose briefly in the room, and they just sort of exposed themselves to the future and ran out. The future having unfolding behind me, and we already know what it is. So their gesture of sort of flashing the future was takes on significance. So, at this point, other things happened. There were several of these performances and more of the lecture, and I'm going to actually end this with a piece of the lecture, the end of the lecture then, and then another question, and then I can proceed to part two. Technology, with its utopian engineering, will do nothing but speed up the slicing of humans into thinner and thinner slices of marketing reflexes. Its only purpose to remove the equally growing boredom that, as Baudelaire said in Lowell's translation, among the vermin, jackals, panthers, lice, gorillas, and tarantulas that suck and snatch and scratch us and defecate and fuck in the disorderly circus of our vice, there is one more ugly and abortive birth. It makes no gestures, never beats its breast, yet it will murder for a moment's rest and willingly annihilate the earth. It's boredom. Tears have glued its eyes together. You know it well, my reader, this obscene beast, chain smokes yawning for the guillotine. You hypocrite reader, my double, my brother. Without knowing exactly what is going to happen, the lecture ends, so you have voted for boredom, voted against boredom, and now have fascism. For all talk of enhanced and virtual realities, the first fully awake AI will make humans obsolete. Today we live in the transitional glasshouse echo chamber of the internet, but our automated life is not essentially different than that of people at the beginning of the 20th century. They too would have preferred to live a life free from the iron fist of the coming dictatorships of the 20th century. They should have chosen Dada instead of Bolshevism and fascism. Our bodies are now almost completely at the service of design. The house, the car, the iPhone, the laptop, the pillbox, most of the non-flesh surround. If 60% of your body is now living within mechanical, electronic, and bioelectronic design, you will need Dada as a corrective to what will certainly be the loss of the modicum of liberty that you still possess. Given the history being made today, I mean then, I would like to note some other types of history. So, is there another question? Yes. Well, I don't regard my experience of LSD as consisting of hallucinations. I mean, you know, in the sense that, yes, I mean, things were distorted from their familiar shape. But essentially, I think that LSD was a profoundly magnifying teacher, a teacher who magnified reality, hyper-reality of the senses and the vision, and there was the hallucinatory aspect of it is only seemed that way in the sort of narrow quotidian horror perspective that we possess at all times. And I highly recommend it, except to the truly psychotic among you. Just keep it. Oh, that's us. I'm sorry, I just answered your question. The book is supposed to do it. Okay, well, I'll open the book and then I'll end this part completely. Well, this book, yes. Uh-huh. Well, we have a new kind of human, so this is advent of the parahuman. As in paramilitary. Not the post-human was half machine, but the post-human indentured to the machine in exchange for staying half human. The parahuman works outside the machine, which has become smart enough to overcome itself by employing its unpredictable human half to teach itself unpredictability. The parahuman is a mercenary fighting for the enemy in exchange for being allowed to be the enemy. So parahumans are already among us. Well, part two. I'm going to put this down and take a sip of water. Well, I think now this particular, I have no idea what time it is. Is it time to have a few questions and end the show? Okay, well, yeah, I'll drink some water, and then if you do have some questions that have to do with close to the some answerable thing about that, I'll certainly do that. Who do you, okay. Okay, that's good. It's probably too far from, I'll just pull it up a little bit. Okay, Jennifer is going to point to the audience and take the questions, and I'm going to try and answer them by myself without the aid of books. Do some work here, you know. That's what I'm being paid for. Okay. All right. Well, any questions actually having to do with putative subjects, historically or actually about Dada, and the exhibition next door, which you must see because it's like looking at the springs of the century and an hour of a quarter. Yeah. Oh, sorry.
So in your talk, it sounded like you were saying that that in some ways there was a competition between ideology and Dada, but at the same time it seems to me that Dada is a response to a feeling of being betrayed by language. In some ways I do feel like Dada has won.
Well, Dada has definitely won. We have all been betrayed by language. And by the horror of the last century, and the ongoing history that supposedly at the end of the communist dictatorships had ended, according to some wrong-minded scholars, but history continues and language continues to betray us, and Dada reflexively says no to the orders of language and to utopian ideas that are ordered in consequence. So yes, Dada has definitely won. But whether we recognize that or not is going to become more difficult now because it's easy to, I think that within chaos, there are other kinds of laws that operate. And the way they're doing in quantum, we're not quite sure which chaos is truly creative. And which chaos is, in fact, an ideology disguised as distraction. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sure.
It looks to me, when I look at the art world today, that Dada has just taken it over, that it's just Dada-inspired stuff everywhere. But with what, maybe you reject the premise, but anyway, that's how it looks to me. And with one big difference, that there's so much money involved. And I was wondering how you thought money and Dada interacted.
Well, the art, poetry is the currency. I mean, language is the currency as well. It's not, you know, the default currency is certainly not the dollar. It's the it's language and art. The sort of uniquely, I hate to say it in this particular way, but almost any work that has the print, the individual print of a person or a group of people who make it, in fact, becomes an non-replicable object or activity, and that is a currency, that is a unit of currency. And I think that in the form of art activity exchange, you know, we're going to create a different kind of economy, so that it is essential that everybody become an artist, just like the Dadaists envisioned it, because we don't need the audience. The audience is parasitical, and that's the audience that consumes and uses money as a currency, saying, well, you can trust this particular piece of paper because it is what we use between us to exchange a creative activity for the privilege of really doing nothing. You know, also for the privilege of becoming a victim in the end. And so I would say that it's sort of urgent that, that this sort of artistic spontaneity start penetrating our thinking at all levels about every kind of thing we think about. What does about the architecture of our we live in, about, you know, the way we dress, and ultimately about the way we walk, because this is much better. You know, the quadrupedal walk is much easier on your back to walk on all fours. Because the worst thing about it, people complain of back pain all the time. So, I mean, it's the greatest complaint ever. Now, walking on all fours would obviously force a redesign of everything that we know in the way of clothes, fashion, architecture. You can start slowly at first, you know, 5 minutes a day in your own house. You know, eventually you'll venture outside and do it for a little longer, and 20 minutes longer than 25, you know, eventually you'll not feel embarrassed at all about doing this, because your, you know, your fashion would have changed, and the appropriate, you know, muscles will grow, and there will be pads for the knees and so on. So yeah, I mean, that it is important to change all of that somehow. The idea is at some point, since, you know, that people stood, you know, became vertical creatures, it was to surveil the environment and to gain power over everything else in the ecosystem. And we did, and we're very successful at that, because we stood up and then we made tools and went on, you know, to verticalize ourselves continually. And the vertical keeps going on, and in certainly New York is becoming taller. Buildings are getting bigger. Trump Tower is Kafka's castle. And everything goes up. And there is this tremendous arrogance toward everything else that lives around us, especially in, not in the city, but in outside of the cities. I lived in the woods for 7 years, and I never felt alone, because I always felt that there were creatures looking at me, that there were this environment that was completely at home, that was watching this loud and obnoxious thing walk through their world. And so I think quadrupedalism is going to be my new evangelical mission. I know it came a bit from...
Sir, you mentioned two manifestos, the 1848 Marxist one and the 20th century Marionettes. One led to Stalinism, the other underpinned fascism. Now we have a kind of Dada-esque incoherence in the White House, and you have manifestos that relate to anti-immigration, anti-Islamism. Do you consider this a perversion of Dadaism or a logical extension?
Well, this is what I was trying to, when I spoke of chaos, you know, and sort of in, within the chaos of what's going on, being able to distinguish between what is creatively, what is creatively good for humans, and what is actually just chaos that disguises an ideology. I think what we have, and that what is called chaos, and that some people call a Dadaesque spectacle in governments, I think that is actually a diversionary chaos. It's a false chaos that is, in fact, hiding an ideology. And what that ideology is, I think, is probably a combination of you know, all the sick ideologies of the 20th century, plus some additions, because if ideologies learn, I mean, they grow, and this particular one at this point, you know, is just an opinion, seems to me to be a kind of fascism without anti-Semitism. It's an opinion.
The BBC, BBC filmmaker Adam Curtis, I don't know if you've seen his new, they're not quite documentaries, they're more collage, kind of cut and paste propaganda, but he looks at this when New York City was sort of going under financially and there was these takeovers, and he really focuses in on folks like Patti Smith and those folks as having a new kind of individualism, and in a sense, first of all, abandoning the city to Trump, and literally to Trump and these folks, but also using this backdrop of poverty and decay as kind of the setting for their arts. And I'm wondering, is there a true third between this kind of romantic individualism that in some ways, you know, Lou Reed and these folks kind of thrives off of the destruction, or at least poses within it, and Trump kind of, you know, the capitalism?
It's a real good question. I think to the punk was the last sort of romantic revolt that had to take place in an urban decaying landscape, and it did so successfully because first there was no distinction really between the stage performers and the audience, because the audience participated in the same kind of despair, at least in the original version, and all the business of diving and near suicidal stage dives, and you know, raw anger amplified. It was that moment of destruction of the destroyed city did release a great deal of energy, of creative energy, and. But it's interesting now to look from now, you know, at Patti Smith winning the National Book Award, and you know, for a book that's very quiet actually and well behaved, and for the most part written out of complete sentences, and you know, her performance, the you know, when the spirit of Dada completely possessed her, and you know, the people around, so yes, the culture legitimized her as a performer, but at the same time, she has made the inevitable compromise of age, you know, and she also made the compromise of language, because she did write something that was palatable, so where nobody's afraid of people who win prizes, I mean, you know, right now, so clearly, something else is in the making, you know, but I mean, it has to be, it's another crucial moment, and we're living through another crossroads like 1916 of, you know, when history can take these extraordinary turns, and very fast. So, yeah, yes. Good question.
Do you view Dada as a therapeutic response to fascism? Yes. Yeah. Would you view Dada as a therapeutic response to fascism?
Well, Dada is, yeah, it is a violent therapy, you know. I mean, it definitely kills the audience. I never thought of yes, it is a therapy, clearly, because just screaming it like punk or the Dadaists in the Cabaret Voltaire was letting it all out. So there's, I guess, a therapy. It probably has something to do in common with Adamov or the primal scream therapy. Yes, it certainly does, but it's not truly something that you want in the pure form of, well, you don't want it to be therapy. I mean, what you want it is to be the spirit at work, healing itself within the community it creates. And that is both what the Dadaist ended up doing and what the punk scene did. So, yeah, it is a therapy, but it's a therapy in which everybody's a therapist and everybody's also the one that has to be healed. It's a circular therapy. There's a name for it, actually. It's called art. I mean, is art therapy? This is an old, an old chestnut, you know. I mean, what does it do, you know? Certainly therapeutic in some ways, but it's you can't use it in that sense, you know. I mean, because therapy itself is an ideology. It supposes there is at least one healthy or sane person in the room, which. Well, so, I can see. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. So I'm grateful for your help because I always tend to look at this side of the room and I never see anybody in this side. Yeah.
We might have time for one more question.
All right.
I have a really basic question, and that is, if someone asked you, what is Dada, what would your response be?
Dada. This is actually a really big part of Dada, because if you repeat it in Romanian, you can say it ironically, less sort of, really, Dada. So it contains its own answer. It's a paradox that you just can't do anything with it. It's like a live grenade, you know, you just keep playing with it until, you know, hope you'll get away, but. If you actually play with it long enough, it'll blow up. Thank you.